Welcome to this evening's book talk, which features Professor Justin Driver and his book, The Schoolhouse Gate, Public Education, the Supreme Court, and the Battle for the American Mind. Now, this book looks unusual because all of our other books were checked out, so I had to grab the one off permanent reserve. There were no other books available. All right, so The Schoolhouse Gate has received acclaim from both popular publications and law reviews across the country. The New York Times called it indispensable, and The Washington Post labeled it masterful. Dean Erwin Chemerinsky deemed it magnificent, and the Michigan Law Review, and the Yale Law Journal declared it, quote, destined to influence the field for years to come. In addition to being named a notable nonfiction book of the year by the Washington Post and Editor's Choice by the New York Times Book Review, it was a finalist for the American Bar Association Silver Gavel Award and was shortlisted for Phi Beta Kappa's Ralph Waldo Emerson Book Award. A recipient for the American Society for Legal History's William Nelson Cromwell Article Prize, Professor Driver has a distinguished publication record in the nation's leading law reviews. He has also written extensively for general audiences, including pieces in Slate, the New York Times, the Washington Post, the Atlantic, and the New Republic, where he was a contributing editor. A member of the American Law Institute and the American Constitution Society's Academic Advisory Board, Professor Driver is also an editor of the Supreme Court Review. Professor Driver teaches and writes in constitutional law. Prior to joining our faculty here at YLS this past summer, he was the Harry N. Wyatt Professor of Law at the University of Chicago. Professor Driver is a graduate of Brown, Oxford, where he was a Marshall Scholar, Duke, where he received certification to teach public school, and Harvard Law School, where he was an editor of the Harvard Law Review. After graduating from Harvard, Professor Driver clerked for Judge Merrick Garland, Justice Stephen Breyer, and Justice Sandra Day O'Connor. Please join me with a warm welcome to Professor Driver, not only for this book talk, but also as a new member of the Yale Law School community.
Okay, so thanks so much for that incredibly warm introduction and for the warm welcome to Yale Law School. I've been talking about this book for a while now. I was just saying it's come out in paperback, so it's quickly getting too late for me to dine out on this book, but maybe one last time. So one of the questions that I've encountered when I talk about the book is how long did it take to write? Whatever else its virtues, it's not a short book, right? And my answer to that question is that it took me either 4 years or 3 decades to write, depending upon how you look at it. The 4 years is immediately after I moved to Chicago, I decided that I wanted to take on a book project. That was, for me, sort of the ultimate form. I enjoyed writing the law review articles, but I wanted to take on a more sizable project. And the 3 decades part is that it dates back to my time growing up in Washington, D.C., I attended public schools in D.C. I grew up in southeast D.C., a predominantly black neighborhood. Starting from a very young age, I went from far southeast across the Anacostia River to way upper northwest Washington. It's opposite number in every sense, including with respect to the composition of the schools. And this is a journey that required me to be on a bus and 2 different subway lines. And, I didn't have a whole lot to think about, right? This is before the age of the cell phone. But one of the things that I did think about was, why am I undergoing this incredibly long journey? What opportunities am I gaining as a result of this sort of journey across the city? And importantly, what are my neighbors who are going to the local public school, what are they not gaining as a result of this? And so that was a really seminal moment for me. I remember learning about Brown versus Board of Education right after I started going to school in Upper Northwest Washington, right around when I was 10 years old. So this is around 1985. And I remember learning about the integration of the public schools, very much in quotation marks, in the sense that I was aware that within shouting distance of the Supreme Court's Marble Palace, there were all black schools, right, where Brown versus Board of Education may as well have been a rumor, and that drove home for me the sense in which there's often a gap between law on the books and life in the streets. Okay, so what I'm going to do today is to give you an overview of the book, and then I will talk about three of the topics that I care about particularly, and I hope that they'll be of interest to you. And then I will, of course, open it up to questions, comments, and objections as well. That's an important part of our engagement. Okay, so the overview. I view the book as offering an examination of the intersection of two important American institutions, the public school on the one hand, and the Supreme Court on the other. And the core claim of the book is that it's difficult, if not impossible, to understand one institution without thinking about the other. And so with respect to the public school, we don't often think about public schools as being legal institutions, but it becomes clear when you step back to examine the whole host of constitutional rights that exist within the schools, that they are legal institutions and that the Supreme Court has offered students a whole host of constitutional rights, and those rights are particularly identified with the school. That is to say that a minor has different rights when they are in the public school than when they are in the public park across the street after school. And so one goal for the book is to try to offer, again, a panoramic look at the whole host of students' constitutional rights. And so I have chapters on freedom of speech, a chapter on criminal procedure, chapter on school discipline, thinking about suspensions and corporal punishment, a chapter on the Equal Protection Clause with respect to race, here Brown and its fallout, right through the parents involved in community schools case. I've got another chapter on equal protection, thinking about issues of school financing and sex separation and, importantly today, transgender students and accessing restrooms. And then the final chapter is on religion, and thinking about obviously the Establishment Clause and the Free Exercise Clause. And I contend that when you sort of take in the vast array of students' constitutional rights, that the public school is the single most significant site of constitutional interpretation in the nation's history. I say that for a few reasons. One is the magnitude of the public schools. There are more than 50 million students who attend public schools around the country. It takes several million adults to sort of run these public schools, and that means that on any given school day, roughly 1/6 of the American population is in public schools. This is the first sustained exposure that students have to a governmental entity. And the lessons that they take there, the lessons that they learn there, they're going to take with them often through the rest of their lives. And so that is absolutely sort of an important part of the book. And, you know, the Supreme Court itself has made this claim that the public school is a particularly important site of constitutional interpretation. You think about the Barnett case from the 1940s dealing with the mandatory flag salute for Jehovah's Witnesses. And the Gobitis decision from 3 years earlier in 1940 said that it is permissible. It does not violate the Constitution to require students to pledge allegiance to the flag. But the Barnett decision reverses that in a magnificent opinion by Justice Jackson, where he says, if there's any fixed star in our constitutional constellation, it's that no official, high or petty, can prescribe what shall be orthodox. And he goes on to say that if we don't honor constitutional rights within the school, that we are going to teach youth to discount these principles as mere platitudes. And Jackson says we risk strangling the free mind at its source. Incredibly evocative language about the importance of recognizing students' constitutional rights. Okay, so that's the first piece of it, the public school. I think of myself, though, primarily as a constitutional law scholar who was examining the public school as a particular theater of constitutional interpretation in order to enter larger debates about the Supreme Court's role in American society. And so that's where I say that in order to appreciate the Supreme Court's role, it's helpful to have the public education cases in mind. And that is so because when you look at these education cases, they confound a major thrust of legal scholarship today, which holds that the Supreme Court of the United States is a frail institution, one that is mirroring larger attitudes in American society. When the Supreme Court attempts to vindicate rights, it is often unsuccessful in doing so. It harms the very rights that it's seeking to help. One hears a lot of this talk about, you know, social movements, right? It's necessary to have a social movement in order for the Supreme Court to issue a durable decision. If you want real change, you take your business not to the courthouse, but to the state house. These are familiar claims to you all in this room. And I think that those absolute claims are, or at least in their strongest form, they're overstated. And so one of the things I try to do in the book is to identify instances where the Supreme Court has successfully vindicated minority rights. And so I identify a few different instances. Here we might think about the Barnett decision itself, which I mentioned a moment ago. From 1943, we're at the height of World War II. Patriotic sentiment is obviously running incredibly high. There are flag stores and sort of stores of patriotism all over the country that are having difficulty keeping the American flag in stock. And these laws dealing with the requirement of the flag salute are on the rise. In 1940, at the time of Gobitis, schools in 15 different states had these sorts of laws. But by the time of Barnett, in 1943, there were these laws in all 48 different states. And so you can imagine their popularity as well, particularly in smaller communities. You can also think about the Meyer versus Nebraska decision from the 1920s, which dealt with an English-only requirement forbidding people from teaching foreign languages. The concern is about German at this time, and people are deeply frightened about this. There are all sorts of efforts to change words that were common in English. People wanted to do away with the term kindergarten, right? They wanted to do away with the term, you know, hamburger and instead call it Salisbury steak and these sorts of things, right? So there's real anxiety about the German language, and nevertheless, the Supreme Court of the United States invalidates these laws that are found more or less all over the country. Okay, there's another part of this that I want to talk about for a moment that builds on some of my academic writing that's clear in the book, some of my, I should say, my writing that was in law reviews. And that's thinking about the phenomenon of constitutional outliers. This is a claim that constitutional law scholars use to describe the phenomenon where the Supreme Court invalidates a practice not found all over the country, but instead found in a small number of states. Right? They say that when the Supreme Court does that, we shouldn't view this as a momentous intervention in society. It's instead just sort of a mop-up operation, right? It's just taking care of a small phenomenon. Wrote a paper a few years back in a law journal where I say that this is a helpful concept. It is illegitimate for scholars just to assume that a legal decision changes the law all over the country. Instead, you really do need to roll up your sleeves in order to find out how prevalent these sorts of laws were. Nevertheless, I think that the term outliers may be a broad umbrella term and that we would do well to distinguish among various types of outliers, including what I refer to as a holdout measure as distinct from an upstart measure. When I think about a holdout measure, I'm thinking about something that was once quite prevalent and then has contracted to be found in only a small number of states. Think about Griswold versus Connecticut, where anti-contraceptive statutes were quite prevalent, and then they retreat to, you know, the great state of Connecticut and maybe Massachusetts as well, right? That's a holdout, and it's possible to understand that as a relatively modest intervention. That's quite distinct, however, from an upstart piece of legislation where the state is the first in the nation to adopt this sort of measure. And in my book, I write about the Plyler versus Doe case from Texas, where Texas has a statute that says it's permissible to exclude unauthorized immigrants from public schools. People say, and the Supreme Court of the United States invalidates that measure. People say again, well, it's only Texas, you know, only those cowboys down there would be drawn to such an outlandish measure, right? But when one steps back to think about it, you can quickly understand that the appeal of such a statute would have been far from confined to Texas. And instead, they would have been found all across the country. We know very well today that anxieties about unauthorized immigrants are found throughout the country. And I found polling data that suggested that these sorts of measures did enjoy a majority of support, that they more people would have passed them had the Supreme Court not interred that sort of legislation in Plyler versus Doe. And a similar claim could be made about Pierce versus Society of Sisters, dealing with requiring people to attend public school. The anxiety was about parochial schools, in particular Catholic schools. They were thought to be preventing people from becoming Americanized. So while Oregon had that, the only such statute at the time, again, there's reason to believe that it would have become more widespread. And there's a similar phenomenon in a case called Stone versus Graham, a relatively obscure case dealing with religion. Kentucky required the Ten Commandments to be posted in classrooms around the country, and the United States Supreme Court invalidated that measure. And again, there's no doubt that other states would have adopted these sorts of measures. It didn't have particular appeal in Kentucky. Okay, so now I'm going to talk about three different topics and cases that I care particularly about, and that I, at least in some instances, will hope that the Supreme Court will revisit. And when I do so, I'm going to talk about some of the personal narratives that are behind the cases. One of the things that struck me as I was researching this book was the way in which the students and their families who were bringing these cases often demonstrated enormous sort of reservoirs of courage in order to stand up not only to their school officials, but also their surrounding communities, right? That it made them often unpopular. And that's certainly true with the first case that I'm going to talk about out of the realm of free speech, dealing with student speech, thinking about Tinker versus Des Moines Independent Community School District. This is a case from the 1960s. In December of 1965, there are students in Des Moines who want to wear black armbands to school in protest of the Vietnam War. And the school officials get wind of this, and they say, oh no, that's too hot of a topic. People feel, at the time, generally supportive of the Vietnam War. This is before the rise of mass mobilization against that war. And significantly, they say that we've had a graduate of the Des Moines public schools who died over in Vietnam, and his buddies are still here in this school. And if you all wear these black armbands, his friends are going to take it as though you are dishonoring his memory and his sacrifice. And so in order to keep the peace, you all cannot wear this. As I said, the Tinker family was visited with all sorts of vitriol, and they got lots of prank phone calls. There were sort of threatening letters that were sent to the home, and the Tinker household itself was splattered with a bucket of red paint. The evident implication would be that only a communist, a red, would dare to oppose the Vietnam War. It's an open question at the time as to whether students have free speech rights. Do they have to simply follow what the school administrators have to say? The Supreme Court of the United States says that they do have free speech rights, and that gives me the title for my book. It's an opinion by Justice Fortas. He says, it can hardly be argued that students shed their constitutional rights at the schoolhouse gate. It's a really momentous opinion, in the sense that he says that America, one of the things that defines America, is its clamorous, open engagement, that people are free to have disputes. And he says that it would be odd if we turned our schools into enclaves of totalitarianism, where we treat students as closed-circuit recipients for the message that the teacher wishes to deliver. He really does wrap up the opinion with a style of patriotism. And while he says it can hardly be argued that students shed their constitutional rights at the schoolhouse gate, many people doubted that proposition. I found polling data that suggested that a majority of respondents thought that students should not have the right to be able to do their protests. And I should drop a footnote here and say that when respondents were asked this in 1969, the students who would have sprung most readily to mind would have not been K through 12 students, but instead college students. There's all sorts of unrest on college campuses, thinking about Students for a Democratic Society, Mark Rudd, Columbia University. These are the students that people would have feared. So if a majority of respondents thought that even college students shouldn't have had these sorts of rights, you can only imagine how weak the support would have been for high school students, because the fear very much was that the sort of rancor that existed on college campuses was going to filter down into high schools. Justice Hugo Black wrote a vehement dissenting opinion. He felt so strongly that he spoke aloud from the bench for more than 20 minutes. And he said, "I want it known that I disown any sentence, any word, any part of what the Supreme Court does today." He was sort of fairly frothing at the mouth, and so much so that Chief Justice Warren is purported to have said, "Old Hugo really got caught up in his jockstrap on that one," right? That he was so sort of twisted around and everything that this is unimaginable that he said this. And so if Black did sort of become incredibly exercised about this, some people have turned to an event from his personal life in order to explain what was going on. Hugo Black had a grandson who was in school in New Mexico. The grandson produced an underground newspaper, and it was quite critical of school administrators. And the school suspended Hugo Black's grandson. And so and Hugo Black wrote a letter to his daughter-in-law and his son, saying, in effect, the school did exactly the right thing here. Students are there to be seen and not heard. Ours is turning into a permissive society. This will not stand. Obviously, in my view, it is a mistake to view Black's statement as one elderly grandfather's fit of pique, and instead, it's consistent with the attitudes that existed among most people in the 1960s, and indeed that exist to this day. There remains real uncertainty and anxiety about the legitimacy of student speech. I saw this firsthand when I was a law clerk at the Supreme Court. And the Supreme Court heard a case called Morse versus Frederick. That's the formal name for it. Everybody calls it instead the Bong Hits for Jesus case, right? So this grows out of an event in Juneau, Alaska, where a high school senior is late to school one day. His name's Joseph Frederick. And the school has excused students from class in order to observe the Olympic torch making its way through Juneau, right down Glacier Avenue in Juneau, Alaska. So Joseph Frederick shows up. He has a sign that reads, of course, "Bong Hits for Jesus." He unfurls it across the street from the school, and his principal, Deborah Moore, sees it, marches over, tells him to drop it. He refuses to do so. She snatches it out of his hands and then proceeds to suspend him for 10 days. Question is, does this punishment violate his free speech rights? Chief Justice Roberts writes the opinion for the court, and it's a highly unusual opinion in the sense that the rule that he articulates is that if the principal reasonably believes that the speech in question is designed to promote illicit drug use, then it's permissible to punish the student for the speech. I say that's unusual from a First Amendment perspective because typically you're required to have viewpoint neutrality, and that you're not permitted to silence one side of the debate because to do so prevents the marketplace of ideas from working correctly. People should be free to be able to mix it up and exchange ideas on these topics. Nevertheless, here, Chief Justice Roberts wrote the opinion in a way to say that it's totally permissible to silence what's regarded as pro-drug speech because of the problems that exist in drugs in American society. Justice Stevens wrote a dissenting opinion. It was, in my view, a powerful opinion at the time, and it's become more powerful still. Justice Stevens said, "Why should we not view Joseph Frederick as attempting to participate however inarticulately, in a growing debate about the legality of marijuana. Stevens was quite elderly at the time, and he said, I can remember the days of prohibition. And we should see this in a similar light. That is to say, the force from the prohibition analogy comes from the fact that what is illegal today can become legal tomorrow, and how does that work but for people making claims, in a wide range of activities about the legitimacy of changing the laws. So given the transformation in the legal landscape with respect to marijuana laws, it seems to me that Stevens's opinion assumes only added force. So while Justice Black lost with respect to the First Amendment on the question in Tinker, there are those who claim that he has won the war. The only good day for student speech in the Supreme Court was the Tinker decision, and there have been many negative decisions in the aftermath. Okay. The Fourth Amendment, and I'll be relatively brief here, I'm thinking about suspicionless drug searches and a case involving Lindsay Earls. She is a student at a school in Oklahoma and about 40 miles outside of Oklahoma City. She's in her first period class. She is summoned to the girls' restroom where she has to provide a urine sample. The reason for this is that she participates in extracurricular activities, and her school district adopted a measure saying that if you do that, you're subject to suspicionless drug testing. So Earls talked about going into a stall and having a teacher posted outside listening for the telltale sounds of urination. She heard teachers joking about they were putting the students through a big potty training exercise, right? She emerges from the stall, hands the vessel to the teacher. The teacher inspects it for, to make sure it's the correct temperature, and then holds it up to the light to look at the color and clarity. And the question is whether the Fourth Amendment's prohibition on unreasonable searches and seizures offers protection against this. You would think, as an ordinary matter, that this would be impermissible because this is a dragnet search. Right, where the government, in effect, is swooping up a bunch of information and seeing what will emerge. And dragnet searches are traditionally disfavored because the intrusion into an individual's privacy is great and the likelihood of finding anything on any individual is quite low. Nevertheless, the Supreme Court of the United States upheld this search, even though they twisted themselves analogizing to a case that was decided just a few years earlier involving student athletes. The previous opinion involving student athletes was incredibly narrow, dealing with one particular school and its extreme drug problem, and the circumstances did not at all exist in Earls. Nevertheless, the Supreme Court upheld this, and it makes one think that there may well be a drug exception. Lindsay Earls also subject to all sorts of vitriol. In her small part of Oklahoma, she said that, people said that she just really wanted to use drugs, that she had lost sight of her Christian faith. This is a charge that carried real venom in her part of Oklahoma. And that she was really doing this because she had a real desire to use drugs. And it may not be surprising that she encountered this in Oklahoma, but these sorts of sentiments, at least some of these sentiments, were uttered at the Supreme Court of the United States as well. During the oral argument, Justice Kennedy made a claim where he said, the only people who would send their kids to druggy schools are you and your client, right? And apparently, he turned red-faced with emotion. He was typically pretty sober and subdued in these settings, but this is a testament to the way that these cases really gets people's blood boiled. Okay, the last case that I'll talk about before I open it up is the Ingram versus Wright decision that deals with corporal punishment. This is a case from 1970. It comes down in 1977, but the events themselves date back to Miami, Florida. Thinking about James Ingram, an eighth grade student at Charles R. Drew Middle School. And he is on stage at an assembly with some of his buddies. and he's instructed to get off of the stage. He does so with an insufficient sense of alacrity and for that pretty classically adolescent form of misbehavior, he is summoned to the principal's office where he's supposed to receive 5 licks in the parlance. This is 5, you know, blows with a 2-foot-long wooden paddle. And when his turn emerges, he protests his innocence, whereupon 2 assistant principals grab him and, you know, they bend him over the table, so one is holding his arms and the other is holding his legs. And he receives not 5 licks, but 20 licks. And this attack is so savage that James Ingram seeks medical attention, and a doctor prescribes cold compresses, pain relievers, sleeping pills, laxatives. He returns 3 days later after this event. And again, a full 3 days later, I found a doctor's notes that say that he has a bruise that is 6 inches in diameter that is purplish, tender, and also oozing fluid. And this is part of a larger reign of terror that existed at Charles Drew Middle School, where students were hit for the most modest of infractions, including sitting in the wrong seat for having untucked shirt tails. And sometimes there would be sort of collective sanctions, right, where students in the back are acting up and they say, that's it, you all are going to get it, in order to incentivize people to mind others. And the school district sought to defend the practice, and they made matters worse. There was one principal from a Miami Beach senior high school where he said, oh no, we don't use corporal punishment in this school. We have a predominantly Jewish student population, and there's a tradition of oral persuasion, and so we don't need to subject the students to this. Charles R. Drew Junior High School is an all-black school, I should say. And the obvious implication is that the students at the all-black school understand only brute force. And so the question before the court is whether this violates the Eighth Amendment's prohibition on cruel and unusual punishment. You might think that this would be a slam dunk case, given that it's such an egregious instance and part of a school where there is something like a reign of terror that exists. Nevertheless, in a 5-4 decision, the Supreme Court rejects the claim and says that cruel and unusual punishment has, in effect, no meaning in the public schools at all. That in order to qualify as cruel and unusual punishment, that has to stem from a criminal conviction. And because there's no criminal conviction here, there's no claim. There's also a due process claim here as well, where a few years earlier, students were afforded modest due process rights before they were to be suspended. And you might think, again, that if you have the right to an informal hearing before you can be suspended, that you, of course you would have a right to an informal hearing before you receive corporal punishment. But that's not how the Supreme Court of the United States saw it. So you might think that this practice has been outlawed. That is not so. Corporal punishment continues to exist. Students are the sole remaining group of people in American society who can be struck for something like the refusal to follow orders. There are 18 states that continue to permit corporal punishment, but in some ways that overstates its prevalence, because just 5 states account for more than 70% of the instances of corporal punishment. Those 5 states are all in the Deep South. And it will come as no surprise to many that those students who receive this are disproportionately people of color. So when I was writing some of the book, I thought that my old judge, Judge Garland, was going to become Justice Garland. And I thought that some of these topics that I've written about might well find a more receptive audience at the Supreme Court. Things didn't turn out that way, unfortunately, in my view. Nevertheless, that does not mean that all hope is lost, including for the 3 areas that I've just spoken about today. It's possible to imagine a coalition of liberals and the libertarian-inflected vision of constitutional law that is ascendant in some right-leaning circles to grant relief in these three areas. Think about the freedom of speech, the Fourth Amendment, and the Eighth Amendment. The traditional libertarian approach is that you ought not get involved in this and regulating the freedom of speech. John Roberts, Chief Justice Roberts, has said that he's a real friend of the freedom of speech. It would be nice if that same sort of principle were there in the context of student speech. The Fourth Amendment is a similar thing. Indeed, I found some statements from libertarians even at the time saying that we should not allow school officials this sort of ability to be able to collect samples simply for participating in an extracurricular activity. And in the most acute instance of all, I would think about the Eighth Amendment, right? I mean, in what instance does the state exercise dominion over an individual in a more profound way than in when it strikes someone? So there may well be brighter days ahead. Okay, I'm just going to wrap up quickly here by saying that, you know, I know that there are some skeptics out there, even at Yale Law School, about what I've said today, and that's okay. You have a friend in high places. Justice Clarence Thomas, who was just here, is a real skeptic of the legitimacy of student rights. In the Morse versus Frederick case that I mentioned a moment ago, he wrote a very strong dissenting opinion saying Justice Black was exactly right. We made a terrible turn when we gave students rights. And also Judge Posner of the Seventh Circuit has said something similar in a 2008 case involving, again, student speech. He says, a heavy federal constitutional hand on the regulation of student speech by school authorities would make little sense, for the contribution that kids can make to the marketplace in ideas and opinions is modest. This drew an opinion from Judge Alana Rovner, also, of course, of the Seventh Circuit, and I found her argument to be quite persuasive, and it's with that that I'll leave you. She says, in response to Judge Posner, youth are often the vanguard of social change. Anyone who thinks otherwise has not been paying attention to the civil rights movement, the women's rights movement, the anti-war protests in Vietnam and Iraq, and the recent presidential primaries where the youth voice and the youth vote are having a substantial impact. The young adults to whom the majority refers to as kids and children are either already eligible or a few short years away from being eligible to vote, to marry, to serve in the military, and to be tried as adults in criminal prosecutions. To treat them as children in need of protection from controversy is contrary to the values of the Constitution. Okay, with that, I look forward to what you all have to say. Please, give it to me.